Have invited Elder Stephen Snow to introduce him. Elder Stephen Snow is a member of the First Quorum of the 70 of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. He currently serves as church historian and recorder and is the executive director of the Church History Department. He has graciously agreed to introduce Elder Sitati.
Thank you, Paul. It is a real pleasure to introduce my good friend, Elder Joseph Sitati. I've known him for almost 15 years now, having first met him while he was called as the first stake president in Nairobi, Kenya, the first stake in East Africa. Elder Sitati's life has been quite a journey. Raised in a rural village in western Kenya, he learned early in his life the value of education. Persistence, hard work, and the encouragement of early mentors and teachers led him to receive a bachelor's degree in mechanical engineering from the University of Nairobi and an accounting diploma from the Associated of Certified Accountants. He also completed his coursework for an MBA at Nairobi University. His early professional career was with Total Oil, or the Total Group, the fourth largest oil and gas company in the world, and he fulfilled his responsibilities throughout Africa and also spent some time living in France while working with the company. Later, he served as an executive with Reach the Children, a non-governmental charitable organization. Elder Sitati joined the LDS Church in 1986, and since that time has served in many church positions, including branch president, district president, stake president, Area 70, and mission president of the Nigeria Calabar Mission. He also served as the church's international director of public affairs in Africa. As Paul mentioned, he currently serves in his role as 70 in the Perpetual Education Fund Committee, and as an assistant in the director in the priesthood department here in Salt Lake. His wife, Gladys, is a teacher, also well-educated. I have learned with Gladys that still water runs deep. I always try to make it a point to listen when she speaks. Together, they are the parents of five children, although this can be a bit misleading. When I visited their home in Nairobi, I counted what must have been 15 children wandering around the house. They explained to me that, like many African families, they have taken on the responsibility to raise and educate many nephews, nieces, and children of extended family members. Few know that Gladys and Joseph are keen golfers, spending some of their free days on golf courses here in the Salt Lake Valley. I have played with Joseph many times and with Joseph and Gladys a few times. And I've learned you can learn a lot about someone by playing golf with them. Let me just say that Gladys and Joseph enjoy life, love each other, are patient, and are totally honest, even in something as inconsequential as golf. I love these two, and I'm grateful for our friendship. Joseph?
Thank you very much, Elder Snow. I've always felt that Africa would benefit by having you as one of its adopted sons. My brothers and sisters, I truly feel honored and grateful for the opportunity to address you this afternoon. The topic of my remarks is one that evokes sensitivities at many levels in almost all communities of mankind. And I was repeatedly reminded of this as I started reviewing references in order to organize my thoughts for this meeting. I looked up the meaning of the word race as it pertains to people. The Merriam-Webster dictionary defines race as a class or a kind of people unified by shared interests, habits, or characteristics, and who may be grouped as a family, tribe, people, or nation. Historically, the word race is of relatively recent origin, and for most of the time since it was first used, it has been the subject of continuous public debate in social, scientific, religious, legal, legislative, and governmental institutions in almost all countries of the world. People of many different nationalities, including Jews, Native Americans, Africans, and Asians, have been affected. Moreover, despite the discussion being live for several centuries, the matter is not yet settled. My purpose this afternoon is not to contribute to that debate, but to reflect on the impact of the issue of race on the growth of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints among people of Black African descent. In that context, I'll begin by sharing a brief personal background. My wife and I were born in rural Western Kenya in the early 1950s, when the country was under British colonial rule. Kenya became an independent country as we entered our teenage years. My parents had little education and lived off the land as peasant farmers. In our youth, our housing was similar to what you'll see in this picture. It had a grass thatch roof, mud walls, and compacted dirt floors. There was no electricity or running water. We fetched drinking water from a spring about a mile away from our home. As a young boy, the bedding I shared with my elder brother consisted of a cowhide spread on the dirt floor for a bed and a blanket to cover. Now, fortunately, in the tropics, it never quite gets cold even at night. We worked on the farm or took the cattle to pasture when we were not in school. And this was the common experience of life for the average family as the country made its transition to a commercial economy at that time. As Elder Snow has mentioned, my life changed from these circumstances because of education. My wife Gladys and I both graduated from one of the two national universities in the mid-1970s. She later worked for the government of Kenya, rising to become the personal assistant to the Secretary for Education before retiring to become a full-time homemaker after we joined the church, heard the teachings of living apostles and prophets about the family, and exercised faith in the promise of the gospel as we saw the needs of our children grow. I pursued a career in engineering and management, traveling extensively in Africa and Europe in my career and later in my church responsibilities, during which period I lived for a time in Paris, Nigeria, and Ghana. Gladys and I have five grown children, three of whom reside in Kenya and two in the United States. We are blessed with seven grandchildren. Gladys and I met a senior missionary couple of the church in Nairobi, Kenya, 30 years ago, and responded to an invitation to join a small congregation then meeting in their home. The couple was then working on the legal status of the church to enable the establishment of a mission so missionaries could come and congregations could be organized. They had obtained permission to hold Sunday meetings in their home. Before that, for a number of years, I had been searching for meaning in my life. And as I sat for the first time in that small congregation, I felt my spirit stir within me the way I had never felt before. My desire to learn about the church was awakened, and we returned again and again to that small congregation, eventually being baptized 6 months later with Gladys and our firstborn son, Martin. One of the first things I learned about the church was the issue of restriction of ordination to the priesthood for males, and generally to the ordinances of the temple for all persons of Black African descent from the mid-1800s to 1978. As I decided to have a full understanding about this, I sought to know what the Lord has revealed through his prophets about the gospel as it affects all his children in all dispensations of the gospel. I learned the following. One, all people are alike unto God, and he, quote, inviteth all children of men to come unto him and partake of his goodness, and he denieth none that come unto him, black and white, bond and free, male and female, and he remembereth the heathen, and all are alike unto God, both Jew and Gentile. And I read that in the Book of Mormon. Moreover, all who come unto Christ in response to that invitation are children of God by faith and become Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise made to Abraham. Two, one corollary to that principle is that God is not a respecter of persons after the manner of the world. He accepts all those who honor him and who seek after his righteousness. The apostles that Christ chose to lead his early church did not at first fully understand this due to the prevailing worldview which was shaped by the law of Moses. As they were considering how to take the gospel from the Jews to the Gentiles according to the commandment given to them by the resurrected Christ, Peter resisted this direction in the vision in which the Lord offered him all manner of beasts and bid him to kill and eat. After this, he was chastened by the Lord, and then he overcame his misgivings and then made this declaration, quote, this is Peter speaking, of a truth, I perceive that God is not a respecter of persons, but in every nation he that feareth him and worketh righteousness is accepted with him, close quote. Another corollary arises from the promises of the Abrahamic covenant, as the fulfillment of that covenant in its fullness entails conferring the priesthood upon all the children of God among all families or nations who desire it and are worthy. The fullness of times could not truly come until all men who are worthy had unrestricted access to the priesthood. These principles led me to the inevitable question, if this has always been clear in the scriptures, why is it that some, including blacks, more recently, were excluded from holding the priesthood? As I searched for answers to this question, I found peace in the answer that by considering the pattern that a loving Heavenly Father has used in past dispensations of the gospel in bringing forth his great plan of happiness through the priesthood. For example, at the time he made the covenant with Abraham, the Lord chose to restrict the priesthood to Abraham's literal posterity for a time. The biblical record and the account of the Book of Mormon indicate that, except for the Jaredites, who were led to the Americas, all other people, generally referred to as Gentile nations, were excluded from the priesthood, from priesthood service after the confounding of tongues at the Tower of Babel. Another example is that during the dispensation of Moses, we find another instance when the Lord restricted the priesthood to the tribe of Levi among the children of Israel, who are Abraham's grandson, in connection with administering in sacred ordinances in the temple. Now, if you look at it further, you'll find that among the Levites, only Aaron and his sons could hold the office of priest. And even among Aaron's sons, after Aaron, only the firstborn could hold the office of high priest and administer in certain ordinances in the temple. These restrictions were only lifted after the fulfillment of the law of Moses in the dispensation of the meridian of time. Now, Christ made reference to this pattern, of course, knowing that this was an order that that was approved of in heaven. At the time that he spoke in a parable, likening the kingdom of heaven to a man who is an householder who goes out five different times of the day and hires laborers into his vineyard. When all the laborers go to collect their wages, at the end of the day, the householder pays each of them one penny, irrespective of the number of hours worked or the time when they were hired to labor. That parable teaches that it does not matter when one is called to serve in the vineyard of the Lord. All who are faithful in serving will receive a full measure of the blessings of their labor. In the kingdom of God, those blessings are equal according to worthiness and diligence, not according to the time of call to service. This principle applies to the living as well as to those whose ordinances are performed by a proxy after they have passed beyond the veil. And it reaffirms the principle that all men are equal before God and that he is not a respecter of persons. That reality is further confirmed by the restoration of proxy ordinances in the temple. All children of God ever born on the earth, and irrespective of the time or place where they lived, will have the opportunity to exercise their agency to personally accept or reject the plan of redemption before they come to the judgment bar of God at the last day. So, with the background of these principles I have outlined, I would now turn to the issues and questions that were raised in the invitation that I received when Paul Reeves first spoke to me about this this assignment. I think that a good starting point in examining how previous temple and priesthood restrictions impact the international church is to consider how the church has grown among people of black African descent living in Africa or who have recently immigrated from Africa. I would say that the church is growing rapidly in Africa and among recent black African immigrants to Europe and the United States, the two main destinations. At the time the revelation on the priesthood was received in 1978, there were just 7,500 members of all races in Africa. At the end of last year, 2014, there were 450,000 members of the church living in Africa, with another 45,000 black African members living elsewhere. Now, I do not include here the African Americans who have traditionally lived in the United States. I mean, Africans who have emigrated, you know, from Africa to the United States. Of that 45,000, there were about 15,000 of them who have recently come from Africa. And as you can see on this graph, the rate of growth since the revelation on the priesthood has been close to exponential. Now, another way to appreciate how rapid this growth has been is to note that it took 85 years for the membership of the global church to rise to about 450,000, while it has taken an average of about 30 years for the membership of the church in Africa to grow to about the same number. All of the growth we see today has happened since 1978, and it is accompanied by some of the highest new member retention rates in the church today. Now, as you will see on this map, much of the growth has happened in the countries of the Equatorial Belt of Western Africa, including Ghana, Nigeria, Ivory Coast, Democratic Republic of Congo, and also in the countries of Eastern and Southern Africa, including Kenya, Zimbabwe, and Southern Africa. It is remarkable to note that this rate of growth has happened despite the many legal hurdles that had to be overcome in each country to get the church established, and that it continues in an environment in which converts and potential converts face discouragement through the most strenuous efforts of the traditional opposition of the church from the United States, which has been exported to Africa. Among the immigrant population, just to give you an example, over 50% of new members baptized in Europe in the last 5 years are immigrants of African descent. I think that's quite a remarkable reality when you look at it. Now, and this for me underlines the fact that pre-1978 temple and priesthood restrictions on black people have not impacted church growth in Africa to any extent that requires church leaders to address specifically. This rapid growth of the church has been accompanied by inevitable challenges, because the message of the restored gospel and its focus on families is appealing to many. It is easy for missionaries to find converts almost everywhere, and for the church to spread rapidly over a large area. Initial experience with this phenomenon, as the first congregations were organized in the 1980s, quickly brought focus to the principle of establishing and then growing the church from centers of strength. Rural areas are affected by ongoing urban migration of educated young people, and are mostly left without able leadership. In addition, many people in the rural areas are less literate. They still hold fast to traditional cultural practices and therefore find themselves in serious dilemmas when these are not in harmony with the gospel that they have recently embraced. The practical application of the approach of growing from centers of strength has resulted in the restriction of missionary proselyting areas to urban centers, where large populations that are more literate and have a more cosmopolitan outlook to life are found. As members in the towns and cities eventually retire and return to their native communities in the rural areas, having grown in faith, they will introduce the gospel to their own people, because it is a common pattern for people working in the cities in sub-Saharan Africa to return to their rural roots after retirement. An aspect of the challenge of rapid growth is the need for sustained efforts in the training of new local leaders to man new units that are created every year. As an integrated global organization guided by revelation and dependent on local lay leaders to lead the local congregations, the church maintains the purity of the doctrine of salvation through regular teaching of leaders at all levels. Some newly called leaders in Africa often have little experience of teaching the restored gospel or even of leading their congregations. Additional effort is made to help them develop the understanding that is needed for them to become true disciples of Jesus Christ, who can teach and lead with power and authority of the Holy Ghost. Yet another challenge is that the church is growing faster than the rate at which church-owned meeting houses can be built. To ensure that members meet in facilities that invite reverence, the church leases buildings in locations convenient to members, so that those who cannot afford the cost of commercial transportation can walk to church. As you'll see in this picture of a meeting house in Accra, Ghana, the visual result of leasing meeting houses is that it is not as easy to identify church meeting houses in Africa as it is in North America. Challenges that restrict growth include poor security due to terrorist activity, such as that experienced in the past in parts of Nigeria and Kenya, or as a consequence of internal conflict in such areas as the eastern part of the Democratic Republic of Congo. These situations are closely monitored by the church, and precautions are taken to ensure that local members, as well as any leaders visiting from outside these areas, are not placed at avoidable risk. Some governments impose strict limits on the number of foreign missionaries that can serve in their countries. This is often an indicator of internal democratic processes that are not as free as they could be. When this happens, the church works through transparent channels of building good relations with government officials and with citizens of influence to try to overcome restrictions that are harmful to the missionary effort. I'd now like to talk slightly about briefly about the perceptions of the church in Africa. It is not easy to speak about perceptions of the church in a general sense without the benefit of an informed opinion poll. And moreover, perceptions are usually the stuff of which an informed judgment is made, and sometimes incorrectly. But nonetheless, perceptions define reality for those who hold them, and knowing them provides the opportunity to address them in a positive way. Now, to ensure that there is substance of my comments, short of a survey, I shared the questions I received from Paul with some African leaders of the church and requested that they respond to me based on their personal knowledge and experience. So my comments, which are general in nature, benefited from their input. Perceptions of the church in connection with race in Africa before 1978 were based on a practice that was changed by the church in that year through revelation. Most active African saints who have joined the church since then know that this is a reality of the past and have found individual answers in the restored gospel of the plan of happiness that give them understanding and peace regarding the unfolding events of the gathering of the saints in these last days. Those who have found answers choose to look forward to the future with faith and assurance that all things are before the Eternal Father, that his justice is to all men, and that his redeeming love and mercy are extended to all who turn to him with full purpose of heart. A contributing factor that has helped some to deal with this reality is that Official Declaration 2, which is the revelation of the priesthood, came on the heels of the era of the momentous events of African nationalism that led to the end of colonialism. Of those times, British Prime Minister Harold Macmillan at that time remarked in an address in 1960 to the Parliament of then apartheid South Africa, and I quote, "The wind of change is blowing within this continent, and whether we like it or not, This growth of national consciousness is a political fact. We must all accept it as a fact, and our national policies must take account of it. Close quote. In some respects, the restriction of the priesthood is viewed by Africans in the same way as the practices of the time that defined the colonial social and cultural hierarchy. This included the practices of long-established foreign-based mainstream Christian churches operating in Africa during that time. For example, limitations that were considered as legitimate at the time were placed on the African members according to that social and cultural order. The church is not perceived as American, white, or racist any more than other churches originating from the United States, such as the Seventh-day Adventists or the Baptists, are perceived to be. It may correctly be stated that when negative information is communicated about the church, it will often be traced to the traditional enemies of the church in the United States, working to influence the people of Africa to support their own creeds. I think it is safe to say that the saints in Africa function in their local congregations as any other members of the church, and the issue of how they see themselves relative to the saints in America is not something that preoccupies them in the normal course of their lives. Sensitivity to race among African saints may arise when individuals encounter experiences that bring back memories of the past, or that suggest that they belong to a status that is in some way makes them less than fellow citizens with the North American saints. Among those who grew up in the colonial era, memories of life under conditions of inequality are not yet completely forgotten, notwithstanding the desire to forget the past and move forward. Younger African Latter-day Saints have mostly lived in a world that they know to be free and are less accepting of experiences that suggest any form of racial bigotry. Fortunately, in a rapidly growing global faith and in an era of globalization, such experiences are encountered only at the individual level and are the rare exception rather than the norm. When they occur, they highlight the kind of challenges that all who have chosen the covenant path must face and overcome as they strive to become true followers of Jesus Christ. Let me add as a footnote that during the time we have lived in the United States, for a total of just over 3 years now, in two installments, one 6 years ago and just over 2 years since 2013, we have become aware of the deep-seated sensitivity of many African Americans about the issue of race and the priesthood in the church. Let me say with full honesty that I do not feel fully justified to speak about the African American experience, since I have lived most of my life in Africa. However, my hope is that those who are affected by and who relate more directly to the historical context of the race issue in this country will consider the experience of the saints in Africa that I have shared, and by the Spirit find answers that give them peace about their own questions. One of the most beautiful stories that the people of God in the Book of Mormon comes from about the people of God in the Book of Mormon comes from the sixth chapter of Helaman. It tells of a time of great peace and prosperity as the Lamanites became converted to the gospel and worked together in unity with the Nephites to strengthen one another. And I quote, "And behold, there was peace in all the land, insomuch that the Nephites did go into whatsoever part of the land that they could, whether among the Nephites or the Lamanites. And it came to pass that the Lamanites did also go whithersoever they would, whether it were among the Lamanites or among the Nephites. And thus they did have free intercourse one with another, to buy and to sell, and to get gain, according to their desire. And it came to pass that they became exceedingly rich, both the Lamanites and the Nephites. And they did have an exceedingly plenty of gold, and of silver, and of all manner of precious metals, both in the land south and in the land north. They did raise grain in abundance, both in the north and in the south. And they did flourish exceedingly, both in the north and in the south. And they did multiply and work strong, exceedingly strong in the land. And they did raise many flocks and herds, yes, many fatlings. And in the 65th year, they did also have great joy and peace, much preaching and many prophecies concerning that which was to come. Close quote. I think such was the nature of Assyrian people. But we find that this period of great peace, prosperity, and spiritual progress, inspired by love and unity among the people, soon changed, and wickedness returned when some became blinded by pride and the chaos of the world and started to focus their attention on their property and on themselves, that they might flaunt their advantage over their brethren. And I quote another verse. And in the commencements of the 67th year, the people began to grow exceedingly wicked again. For behold, the Lord had blessed them so long with the riches of the world, that they had not been stirred up to anger, to wars, nor to bloodshed. Therefore, they began to set their hearts once again upon riches. Yeah, they began to seek to get gain, that they might be lifted up one above another. Close quote. Let me just note that historically, we have an abundance of examples that teach us that it is the focus on things that define and highlight differences between people that has unleashed the forces that has led to some of the greatest suffering of the children of God in all ages of time. God the Father, knowing this from the beginning, sent his Son to teach and show by example that we glorify the Father and become his disciples as we bear much fruit. That we might do so, he gave the commandment that we love one another. And it means that we strive to stand as witnesses of God and of his love at all times, in all things, and in all places as we interact with his children. Let me now address some comments on the issue of poverty. Many of the saints in Africa are not able to participate fully in all the programs of the church, being limited by the financial means available to them. For example, most young people of missionary service age do not have the ability to finance their own missions or to receive support from their families. Many senior couples, even after retiring from gainful employment, are similarly unable to finance even live-at-home church service missions due to the low retirement pensions that they receive and are obligated to continue working to supplement their income. The problem lies in the low productivity of the economies of their countries, as shown in this chart. You'll see that, say, compared to the United States, where the per capita GDP is 54,000, GDPs of a number of selected countries which have got strong church membership, like South Africa, Nigeria, Ghana, Kenya, Cote d'Ivoire, and Zimbabwe, are only a small fraction of the per capita GDP here. This is a result of a combination of factors, including poor management of the economy by elected leaders and of a largely young population rooted mainly in the rural areas where transition to commercial activity since independence has been slow. With an average median age of 20 for most countries in sub-Saharan Africa, more than half of the population is dependent on someone else. That is really a remarkable reality of just how young the population in Africa, you know, is. And that plays into the issue of GDP. When you are talking about GDP and you have a large denominator of non-productive people, I mean, that is what you essentially end up with. Now, this situation is exacerbated by strong social norms that still expect those who have improved their temporal circumstances to support their less fortunate kindred. While this is morally commendable, the unintended consequence is, in a difficult economic environment, is often to encourage a culture of entitlement and dependence that transfers personal responsibility to others. The church has been proactive in responding to both the spiritual and temporal needs of the saints in Africa. This is one of the blessings of having a living prophet and living apostles. Young people of missionary service age are enabled to serve missions so long as they can make an adequate personal sacrifice as determined by their local leaders who are familiar with their circumstances. So all who want to serve are given the opportunity to do so, despite the significant costs involved, in some cases exceeding the per capita GDP of the country of their countries per missionary. Another example of revelation received and acted upon is the setting up of the Perpetual Education Fund in 2001 to provide a rotating fund for the education of returning missionaries in international areas of the church, including Africa. This fund was set up barely 20 years after the first missionaries were sent to sub-Saharan Africa, and it took only a short time for the need to be recognized and addressed by the church in a serious way. 3 years ago, in 2012, the first presidency built on the foundation established by the Perpetual Education Fund to set up self-reliant services, a doctrinally-based, fully supported initiative providing resources to support members of the church to become self-reliant. This initiative, which was rolled out initially in the international areas, is also being rolled out in North America from last month. This inspired effort opened up opportunities initially offered under the Perpetual Education Fund to all adults age 18 or older. Self-employment and accelerated job search have been added as options to offer more routes to self-reliance according to the situation and preference of the members. This has led to dramatic increase in the number of members being assisted. As you can see on this chart, this priesthood-led initiative is already having a significant positive impact on the African saints who are taking advantage of it, and their lives are being transformed. Let me just explain a little bit here. The self-reliance initiative provides a process during which everyone who is striving to become self-reliant goes through group meetings and learns lessons and is encouraged to apply the lessons learned in those meetings over a period of about 12 weeks, so that at the end of 12 weeks, they are in a situation to, they have a foundation upon which they can build their self-reliance. So what we have done is, in a number of African countries, to track what has happened to people before they enter this process and immediately after they enter this process. And we just ask them a question. Do you take sacrament weekly? Are you temple worthy? Are you saving any money? Do you pay tithing? Do you have any consumer debt? And then we track them after they have taken the training. And what we see is that, in fact, there is quite a significant improvement, which shows that this process is already having an impact even before the full fruits of the training that they have received are realized. On the humanitarian front, the church has been a major benefactor to the nations of Africa, as church leaders have directed resources to alleviate hunger, give hope to the handicapped through the wheelchair program, provide access to clean water to people in rural villages, improve infant mortality rates through neonatal resuscitation training, restore eyesight by donating glasses, cataract surgery, immunizations, support for fighting epidemics such as Ebola. So you'll see from this that in the last 30 years, the value of assistance given by the church to the countries of sub-Saharan Africa has steadily climbed to several hundred million dollars. And a notable aspect of these donations is that most of them have benefited non-members. So let me just say in conclusion that it is important to understand that the priesthood has been restricted in the past dispensations of the gospel to small groups of people. However, I think it is also important to rejoice in the reality that promises made by God to Abraham, and which gave him assurance that a time would come when all families of the earth would be blessed through the covenant that God had made with him, have actually been realized. Now, although we do not fully understand all of the reasons for the restrictions that were imposed in all dispensations of the gospel, including ours, I think it is evident that the Lord acted to suit the work according to the conditions of the children of men. Today, the doctrine of the church confirms that people of all backgrounds, living or who have ever lived on the earth, are children of God and are equal before him. None are denied their blessings. Announcing the end of the practice of withholding the priesthood from black people, the First Presidency declared in 1978 that God had confirmed, quote, by revelation that the long-promised day has come when every faithful, worthy man in the church may receive the holy priesthood with power to exercise its divine authority and enjoy with his beloved ones every blessing that flows therefrom, including the blessings of the temple. Accordingly, all worthy male members of the church may be ordained to the priesthood without regard for race or color, close quote. The people of Africa are hearing the voice of the Lord and turning to him by embracing the restored gospel. Today, the continent is a productive vineyard of the Lord, and the work of the church is largely unaffected by concerns about the past. Moreover, the saints in Africa are not preoccupied by these issues, except as some may only rarely be reminded of the past by those who still have individual struggles in their relations with people of a different color. Through a living prophet and apostles, the church continues to proactively respond to the spiritual and temporal needs of the saints in Africa. The opportunities for personal growth which have been made available to the saints are helping to lay a foundation that will see a peculiar people become increasingly visible amidst the usual despair that is carried by the world media about most things African. They will be identified and recognized by their faith, devotion, and industry. Of this I testify in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.